Make it by yourself. That's how you learn making music.
I found this comment on my ad for the Ultimate Rawstyle Kick Volume 1 sample pack, and I was like really blown away by the logic of this comment. Make the kick by yourself. That's how you learn making music. Make your own knives. That's how you learn how to cook. Make your own lubricant. That's how you learn how to f-. That's the most stupid comment I've ever heard in my life. Obviously, it's fine if you make your own kick, but you don't learn how to make music by making your own kick. Making kicks and making music are like two totally different things. What's up, everybody? I'm Alex at generalguyble.com. Welcome to the sixth video of your viewer comments. And the comments keep coming, and I'm keeping making those episodes because it seems like you guys seem to like it. So let's not waste any time. Let's get into the next comment.
Great video. Thank you for that. Little edit. Using compression on the kick makes sense to me, but not in the main project. In the creating project of the kick, a compressor on the frequencies above 100 Hz really helps making everything in the tail glue together.
Well, thank you, first of all, that you like that video. Yeah, as I already said in that video, it makes sense to use compression on kicks in the designing process, because obviously if you got like a very dry or like, you know, unprocessed kick, already changing the dynamics on that kick will have like drastic effects once you go into your chain. The whole point was like, if you got a kick which is like a complete sausage, yeah, there it doesn't seem like it makes too much sense to compress it, because there are no dynamics to work with. I hope when you say compressing the kicks above 150 Hz, I hope you mean you using multiband compression. You don't use like the internal sidechain filter, because that was also something I've shown in that video. The internal sidechain filter compresses the whole kick, it just like reacts to everything above 150 Hz. So I hope you didn't mess that one up.
Nice pack. I would like to see how you make some Rawstyle kicks from some unusual sources, like, let's say, some ethnic percussion like a taiko. Could be a nice, interesting challenge.
A while ago, I've made in a live stream, I've tried to make a kick just by me making a sound in a microphone, like, and then, you know, with processing and stuff, I kind of made something and I came very close to something that, you know, could be used, but still wasn't that. It's been a while. I've seen an interview from some producer and he was like bragging about that, like on his whole album, he created those sounds out of unusual sources. So he was like, yeah, I put a pillow in front of my couch, was like kicking like crazy against it. Then like with 50 plugins, I made it sound exactly like a kick. And once I heard that, I was thinking like, okay, that's fucking stupid, because you can simply use a kick. And I mean, that wasn't like a hard dance producer. So he was talking about like, you know, a kick like you would hear in hip hop or something. So I was like, okay, that seems to be very stupid. If you put that effort to make it sound like a regular kick, why should you use that? I get the point though, I really do. You know, if you use like unusual sources, you know, there's a different harmonic structure and shit, and you might get a chance to get a sound which you wouldn't get otherwise. So I get that point. Everybody should evaluate for himself if it's really worth the hustle, you know, for something that at the end will still sound like a Rawstyle kick, but like maybe slightly different because you used a completely different source, but maybe you spent like days and days and a lot of experimenting and trying out and failing and stuff to get to the result. Because at some other place in this world, there's some guy sitting there, he's just using a sample and makes like one track after another, and maybe one out of 10 is a fucking banger and the other nine he's gonna trash, but he's still gonna have a much higher output. So again, everybody decides for himself. I think like just as from a challenge perspective, it's interesting, but it's kind of not interesting to me, to be honest, because time is very valuable and I'd rather make another video like that instead of, you know, killing myself making like a kick out of something like completely unusual.
Thank you so much for acknowledging the writings of DJ Fuckface. I've been a follower of him for a long time. Another word of wisdom: when producing, ask yourself WWGGD, which is, what would General Guyble do?
Yeah, you all should ask yourself, what would General Guyble do?
Great video, thanks very much for the rewire workaround. For me, Ableton lost a lot of usability after 9.7. I found the newer built-in synths and effects in L10 and 11 very CPU heavy versus third-party alternatives which were giving me better sound. And I could use the presets I made in the third-party synths in other DAWs, e.g. Reason, Traction, Waveform. But I'm addicted to Ableton Session View for trying out my initial song playground ideas, which I can then arrange in the arranger page. And I use Simpler a lot. I've heard that the new version of Logic have very similar features to Session View and Simpler. Do you find that they are good alternatives to those features in Ableton?
So I have the same feeling with Live 10 and especially Live 11. That was the reason why I kind of switched to Logic nowadays. the CPU usage went like out of the fucking window. And as I said in many videos and live streams, the stability, at least for my part, in Live 11 went really down the toilet, to be honest. Logic has those live loops since I believe 10.5 or something, as well as a ripoff of Simpler. The ripoff of Simpler, I would even argue it's a little bit better, and that's not because it has like some functionalities which the regular Simpler doesn't have. It's because of the artificial intelligence attached to Logic. So you take a sample, you drag it on your empty MIDI track, and then you can already like load that sample optimized. So it's gonna read out your root note, it's gonna, you know, retune it if necessary. So it's gonna do a lot of things by itself, which you don't need to take care of. And that can be very, very helpful. Simpler, or in Logic, its quick sampler, has the same functionalities. You know, you can use it as like a regular classic sampler, or one-shot mode, or slicing mode. And this is a very good tool, and I would say like 100% that is capable of replacing Ableton Simpler. The live loops, I have done a little quick tour with that, but it seems to me it's pretty much the same thing as in Ableton. The only thing you have to consider is the warping or like the whole time and pitch algorithms in Logic. I wasn't like so convinced about it so far. So Ableton, in my opinion, is there still, you know, running the game. But considering all the issues which you have, I would really advise you to try out Logic if you're on a Mac, and probably you will find your way around.
Hello, very loud samples and repetitors.
I think you have to be a very special kind of person, you know, leaving like a one-star review on something that is free. And yeah, with loud samples, that's the thing. You know, when I produce samples, I produce them ready. I remember those days when, you know, I finished like engineering school and I was like, okay, now everything in theory, and everything was like, okay, if I use samples, I need to have room to work with them. I need to be able to process them. I don't want over-processed samples and stuff. In the meanwhile, I've seen like people like really making one banger after another while I'm still compressing a snare or shit like that. Because they just use finished samples which just work, they put them in the mix and it's fine. Maybe sometimes you do a little bit of EQ to make them sit better, but that's pretty much it. At that point, I kind of realized, okay, it's smarter to do all that compression and all that processing, bounce it out as a one shot, and then use it as a one shot, and maybe also in the next track and two tracks from now and whatever. So this is the reason why all the samples you buy on my page, at least like which are produced by General Guyble, are always very loud and quite overprocessed, because the idea is you just toss them in your project and you go ahead. You don't need like for hours and hours tweak your shit. That also doesn't make any sense. If you are into tweaking your shit, why don't you make it from scratch? So this is kind of the whole idea about that. And to me it makes sense, and I guess to the majority of people it makes also sense.
Brutal honesty is always best for the person asking the question. They don't often take it that way though. It's like that old saying, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make them drink. I remember being in a job interview and I was asked what my best and worst traits were. I said honesty for both, and the interviewer was a little confused. I pointed out they like me when the truth is what they want to hear, but they likely be upset when the truth is not longer convenient for them.
This is a very great comment. Not everybody wants to hear the truth. They think they want to hear the truth, but in reality they just want to hear what they want to hear. With honesty, of course, and like saying your opinion, of course, like you always make enemies. A lot of people don't like you. Yeah, this is some, for instance, something why I don't do those feedback sessions anymore. Because there are way too many people who just want to show off and just want to show their track. They don't actually really ask for opinions or really don't ask for an honest feedback. They just want to hear like, dude, you're fucking amazing. You're the next like so-and-so. It's a very good comment, and I believe honesty is very important. I mean, you don't need to be a dick or like, you know, completely rude or something like that. But it's always good to say the truth and, you know, the honest thing, especially if people asking for an honest opinion.
Great video, Alex, as always. Funny and same way strange slash weird comment at the beginning of the video. I hope you did a screenshot with the guy's name for the police. Keep it on the side, you know. I think everyone has their ideas, even tracks not accepted on labels. Nobody said that taste of the guy that checks tracks are good. Maybe he's ready to hear just simple three chords of art tracks. And that's the max level of creativity he accepts for the label. And you created five chords and melody itself. And that is hard for his brain to understand, even it's much more professional than most stuff from the label. Being promoted and getting millions of listeners does not mean that music is professional. Let me give some examples. On Instagram, I always got videos of Madonna vocal and trap beats. It's overused by many. many, but nobody gives a fuck that the bass is out of tune. Yes, it sounds catchy. The original song's melody is catchy, not a simple beat with bass. Just people forgot the original, and this did some flashback. Yes, interesting to know who that guy is from this first comment, if he's talking about the level of your audience.
This comment was on one of the viewer comment videos, and the particular one which started with the threat of somebody like, if you mention my name ever again, I will search you up in Germany. And I don't know, maybe he wanted to give me a bottle of whiskey and give me some flowers. I don't know. I don't think so. Probably he meant to do some physical harm. And of course, I got screenshots of all the conversations and everything. Not really for the police. Just more like, you know, if he continues to be a bitch, you know, I'm gonna publish everything else. But you know, for now I don't want to put fuel in the fire, so I'm gonna put it low. I actually told him in one of my text messages in private, I also told him like, dude, if you continue being a bitch, you know, I'm gonna use that shit in the next video. If you want to find out who that is, it's pretty easy. Just look at one of the comment videos and you will pretty fast see who it is. Because there's only one person commenting quite a lot and being very butthurt. And if you listen to the music, then you will realize this person is extremely delusional because the music is really whack.
Now the 40-year-old question, how old are you?
Well, I'm definitely old enough to be offended by a question like that. I'm 34. This is like a 3 and a 4. So, not that somebody thinks I'm 44, even though I might look like it.
By the way, never a good idea saying if you want me to shit all over you on the internet, LMFAO.
Good old Jay. That's the guy who always find those little bits and pieces in my videos to, you know, recognize the fun things in that.
Hey Alex, how do you level out the different kicks? I always have trouble finding the same levels with different kicks. If you look at a dB meter and level them out, the volume seems the same, but when you listen, there is a difference in volume.
This is a very good question, actually. And there is, unfortunately, no answer to that, because as you said, there is like the technical volume, which is like your peak meter, dB, you know, VU meter, whatever you use, and there is also the perceived volume, and this may vary depending on the frequencies, depending on the structure and overall sound of that kick. My approach is usually that I always try to level out my kicks at around minus 10 dB. Then I try to squash, to clip the lowest kick closer to where the loudest is. I also try to adjust it frequency-wise towards the loudest, because the loudest kick will also pretty much determine how loud your master will get. This comment came up in my live stream where I was mixing a Frenchcore track which had like a pretty much a standard Frenchcore kick, and afterwards I was like more like a kind of a modern, I don't know if that's already like a Dutch Frenchcore kick or if it was just an uptempo kick. And obviously this uptempo kick was a lot louder because it has a lot less low mids and stuff like that, but a lot more distortion. So the only way you can get around is try to at least like from frequency wise to adjust those kicks already kind of similar and try to clip the lowest kick to a still acceptable level where it's not like sounding weird. So you might get a little bit out of it. The other thing you could do is also bring the fader down of the louder kick. But the problem with that is there is a reason why it's produced like it's produced. And usually, like, you know, if the bass levels are pretty much equal, but the high-end levels and distortion levels are different, once you bring the fader down, you also change the bass levels. So, yeah, this is a big pain in the ass. And I remember those times when I did mastering for others. At some point, it got, like, really ridiculous because I had, like, so many EQ automations, because every fucking four bars the kick is changing and every kick needs like still different adjustments on the bass and stuff like that, and it was a fucking nightmare. In other words, you can do little things to come closer, but you can't really do much. At some point you just have to face it that, you know, some kicks will appear louder than others. The only thing, as a producer, if you have the luxury having the project open, make sure the loudest kicks come last and the lowest kicks comes first. So that way you still have like a little bit on of an evolution within your arrangement, and you know, you start with like the last louder kick and the next kick will be louder, the next even louder. Maybe somebody who's watching has a good idea on how to equal them out. This is what I came up with so far, and I can't really think of much on, you know, how to deal with that, especially if those are very, very different kicks. All right, guys, this is it for this episode. Don't forget to leave a like, to subscribe, hit the bell button if you want, and most of all, just leave a comment. Can be something stupid like, hey, I'm John Smith or whatever, I don't give a fuck. But leave a comment, this is good for the algorithm. For you, it's not much work. For me, it goes a long way, and I sure do appreciate that. And before we end this video, let me give you a couple of recommendations what you should watch next. The other day, I posted a review of a new hybrid Rumbler plugin, which is called Horizon. And I got word from the developers that this one will be drastically improved, and it seems to be that it will be probably something of the future which might get relevant, so you might want to be ahead of everybody and have a look on that. And if you're interested in like weird sound design techniques and shit like that, I highly recommend you to check out my video how to make distorted industrial bass loops. So thank you very much for watching, and I see you next time. Bye bye.